God who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
As I get louder, you get louder. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After he had said this, Jesus went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today, he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these palms and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that, joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you through the same Jesus Christ who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
and meditate on the salvation of the world through his suffering, death, burial, and resurrection. Let us pray. Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning. Our first reading will be from Isaiah 50, chapter verses 49, and it reads as follows. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with the word. Morning by morning it wakens my ear. To listen as those who are taught, the Lord God has opened my ear. And I was not rebellious. I did not turn back. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spit. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been distressed. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Here is the first reading. Now we have our song.
Mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in
It's coming from Philippians, the second chapter, verse 5 to 11, and it reads as follows. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, should bend, excuse me, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
See, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man is going, and it has been determined, woe to that one by whom he is betrayed. Then they began to ask one another which one of them it could be who would do this. A dispute arose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But he said to them, the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like you who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I'm among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred on me a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, listen. Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your own faith may not fail. And you, once you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. And he said to him, Lord, I'm ready to go with you to prison and to death. Jesus said, I tell you, Peter took the cock, will not crow this day, until you have denied three times that you know me. He said to them, when I sent you out without a purse, bag, or sandals, did you lack anything? They said, no, not a thing. He said to them, but now the one who has a purse must take it, and likewise a bag, and the one who has no sword must sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you, this scripture must be fulfilled in me. And he was counted among the lawless. And indeed, what is written about me is being fulfilled. They said, Lord, look, here are two swords. He replied, it is enough.
He came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, pray that you may not come into the time of the trial. Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. While he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, Judas, is it with the kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man? When those who were around him saw what was coming, they said, Lord, should we strike with the sword? Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, no more of this. And he touched his ear and healed him. But Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him, have you come out of the swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me, but this is your hour and the hour of, and the power of darkness. Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, this man also was with him. But he denied it, saying, woman, I do not know him. A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, you also are one of them. But Peter said, man, I am not. Then about an hour later, still another kept insisting, surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean. But Peter said, man, I do not know what you are talking about. At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times. And he went out and wept bitterly. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him, prophesy, who is that that struck you? They kept heaping many other insults on him. When day came, the assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said, if you are Messiah, tell us. He replied, if I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God. All of them asked, are you then the Son of God? He said to them, you say that I am. Then they said, what further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips.
Then the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying, we found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king. Then Pilate asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" He answered, "You say so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and crowds, "I find no basis for the accusation against this man." But they were insistent and said, "He stirs up the people, teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began, even to this place." When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad. He was wanting to see him for a long time, because he had heard all about him and was hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at some length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod, with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put on an elegant robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other before they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests and leaders and the people and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people, and here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." Then they shouted out together, "Away with this fellow, release Barabbas to us." This was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for a murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again. But they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" The third time he said to them, "Why, what is the evil he has done? I have found him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him." But they kept demanding urgently with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over to them as he wished. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country and had laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of people followed him, and amongst them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves, for you are the your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren and in the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed.'"
Then they will begin to say to the mountains, "Fall on us," and to the hills, "Cover us." For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry? Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by, watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, the chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him: "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserved for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for the spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, though a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath day, they rested according to the commandment, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you. scriptures read this morning. And we'll get some more of you to read on Sunday morning. Those long lessons, yes. Don't let anybody tell you that we don't read the Bible in this church. We do. Amen. Jackie, where are you, Jackie? Yeah, your father passed, and we are keeping you and your family in our prayers. As we stand in the church over 20 centuries after the death of Jesus, it is to some hard to imagine why people rose up against Jesus and with such vigor. In the book On Being a Christian, Hans Kuhn reminds us that Jesus carried no knife. He had no armed army. He only did good and for the worst sort of people. The crowds condemned him to death, and no defenders stood up that day. A public, some of whom had been his followers, and some who had welcomed him into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. Some of those very people were heard in the assembly to say, "Crucify him." It would be difficult, if not impossible, for any of us to assist in an execution so brutal as a crucifixion. The very thought of doing such thing to a human being sends shivers of horror all through us. We couldn't do it, but are we sure? Are we so different? The state of South Carolina reminded us this past week that capital punishment is still with us. South Carolina has scheduled an execution on April 29th by firing squad. Who's going to do that? The method requires 3 volunteers, all of them Corrections Department employees. They had no problems getting volunteers. As a matter of fact, more people volunteered than they needed. So are we so very different? This week we've watched an event unfurl in Ukraine. A missile strike Friday on a crowded train station used to evacuate civilians in eastern Ukraine, killed at least 50 people, including 5 children. You know, not very much is said or written by the media about the young Russian soldiers who are buried alive in their tanks. I read that as many as 10,000 Russians have perished. The Kremlin said we had significant losses of our troops, and it's a huge tragedy. NATO estimates that Russia has lost 7,000 to 15,000 troops during the 6-week war, while Ukraine puts the total at 18,600. And as Russian mothers and widows grieve, countless bodies are unclaimed in Ukraine. Yes? Russian mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, they too mourn the death of their youngsters. They too are people like us. We mourn the deaths of people killed by terrorist actions around the globe. We're saddened when we hear people publicly gloating over anybody's death. We're saddened when we watch videos of the bodies of innocents murdered as they try to get out of the way of war. We see people joyfully celebrating the retaking of territory, feeling righteous, letting others perhaps bear their darkness and their sin. We are so civilized. Let's look at some people who brought Jesus of Nazareth to
to crucifixion this morning. They were not monsters, but ordinary people with faults that led Jesus to the cross. Who was responsible? The Roman soldiers, Pilate, the Sanhedrin, Caiaphas, the false witnesses, Judas, the indifferent mob, the nameless carpenter who made the cross. Pilate receives most of the blame today for the death of Jesus. And yet, Pilate didn't want to put Jesus to death. Pilate indeed pronounced the sentence, but he first tried every legal strategy to release Jesus. Pilate could see that Jesus hadn't done anything worthy of death. Pilate may have been cruel and scheming and insensitive, but Pilate wasn't a fool. Pilate saw clearly that the Sanhedrin wanted Jesus out of the way because Jesus was a religious annoyance and an embarrassment to the officials of the temple. Why did Pilate condemn Jesus? Pilate found Jesus guilty because he cared more about his comfortable position than he did about justice. People do not always do the right thing. Pilate did not dare to stand for what he knew was right. Kate Bersham wrote, "Courage means standing up for what is right, even when what is right is not popular and you have to stand alone." Has that ever happened to you before, where you had to stand up for something that was right and you found yourself standing all by yourself? Whenever you and I are willing to sacrifice someone else for our benefit, we step on the ground that Pilate stood on when we don't have the courage to stand up for what we see is correct. What would you or I have done in Pilate's position? Are we so much better? I believe that many people who crucified Jesus are very much like we are today. They were victims of what Irvin Yanis, formerly of Yale University, called groupthink. People could kill Jesus because, as victims of groupthink, they had unquestioned belief in the inherent morality of their group. They could kill Jesus because, according to Bishop Oscar Romero, they were inclined to ignore their decisions, ethical or moral consequences. Sometimes we ignore the consequences of the decisions that we make. They would be against any idea or value or whatever because they had stereotypical views of their enemy, who is Jesus. Listen, to kill someone, a person must have a dim and low view of what one is killing. You all remember the story of Emmett Till. He was a little boy from Chicago who went down to Mississippi to visit relatives. Oh, maybe he was 11 or 12 years old. And he was accused of making some kind of gesture at a white lady at a time in Mississippi history when that was just something you didn't do in the deep segregated South. And some men grabbed that little boy and they took a millstone and they wrapped it around his body and they dropped him in the river. You've got to have a dim view of somebody in order to do something that monstrous. The people must have seen Jesus as a religious irritant and a threat. And there was no warrant for arbitration or negotiation. They just simply said, crucify him. Crucify him. Then there was Caiaphas. If he could have bit a little, he was certainly not a demon. Joseph ben Caiaphas was the admired and respected religious leader of the community. Caiaphas, the high priest of Jerusalem, was a devout and sincerely religious man. He was an excellent administrator and a model family member. Why did he seek to have Jesus condemned? He did it for the simple reason that he was too rigid. Now, I know none of you are rigid. I know that you all are as flexible as I am. I know that. He was scared that walking the fine line required to serve his people without unduly angering the Roman governor. He didn't believe that God could be revealed in any other way than through the Holy Scriptures and temple service. He believed in the absolute correctness of the way handed down to him. Jesus upset what was most holy and valuable to Caiaphas. Jesus broke the Sabbath and he cleansed the temple. He spoke with the authority of God, and worst of all, many were taking him seriously. So Caiaphas also conceivably might have felt threatened by a charismatic Galilean leader. Because Jesus expressed regret over events in the temple, and because he chastised the people for their lack of faith, and because he warned the people about their empty, void, and spiritless religion, because he repeatedly called attention to the plight of the poor, the leaders applied direct pressure on him. Professor Yannis says that victims of groupthink do not deviate from what appears to be the group consensus. Group thinkers keep silent about their misgivings and even minimize the importance of their doubts. Some crowd members must have questioned themselves about crying, crucify him. And somebody ought to have said something. See, sometimes in our lives we experience stuff, and we know that what we experience is wrong, but nobody says anything. Nobody says what needs to be said. Sometimes somebody ought to say something, and sometimes you need to say something. You know, it's a bad thing when people don't listen to that small voice inside of themselves called conscience. Every time you and I are carried away by the enthusiasm of accusers and don't think we're guilty of this fault of character that led to the crucifixion, and every time we refuse to speak our peace when we disagree or fail to register our vote, we share in the very failing which enabled a few individuals to ensure the crucifixion of Jesus of Nazareth. And how often do we neglect to take our part? In a democracy such as ours, the nation's sin is ours. With all this stacked against him, Jesus still wouldn't have been crucified except for the indifferent mob of people in Jerusalem who didn't care what happened to this man. Only a few hundred could have prevailed upon Caiaphas, the Sanhedrin, or Pilate, but they didn't care enough to rouse themselves. They had heard him, they admired him, but they weren't there to protest. Indifference to Jesus led to his crucifixion as much as anything else, and those who today are indifferent follow in the footsteps of those who make made possible the great injustice of the story of Jesus. No force harms or hinders the work of Jesus more today than indifference. Not caring enough to be for him or against him. Not caring enough to be for a righteous cause or against one that is not righteous. That's indifference. And we can be very, very indifferent. The cross shows us the qualities in each of us which make for destruction and crucifixion. There are the masks that the monsters of the deep assume to deceive civilized people. The cross helps us measure our lives correctly, our minor daily trespasses and faults. How much do they cost both humans and God? They lead to war and riot. They break human beings, driving them into mental illness and crime. They also nailed Jesus of Nazareth to a cross. The cross reminds us that we cannot be indifferent. The cross reminds us that we are called from time to time to take a stand for good. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join your name in heaven.
God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage.
May our fasting and hunger for justice, our alms and making of peace, and our prayer the song of grateful hearts, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Welcome, especially.